Good morning, everyone. This is Meenal Patil from Jain College of Engineering, and we are having the class on object-oriented modeling and design. Since it happens to be the start of syllabus, first I would like to introduce you to the importance of the subject as to why we are going to deal with this entire subject throughout the semester. First, we need to understand what do we mean by an object, and we all of us know that it's an instance of a class. Now, what do we mean by a class? It's a blueprint for creating objects, providing initial values for state member variables or attributes and implementations of behavior, member functions or methods. Now, this happens to be the technical definition, but in practicality, when you try to imagine what you mean by an object or a class, class happens to be something where you can classify things and then it happens to be a class. For example, fruits happens to be a class, and the objects are name any fruit like grapes, mango, apple. So all these happens to be object. If I take a furniture class, then the desk, table, chair all happen to be the object of the class. We know that class is just a template where an object is a real-time entity. Then what do we mean by a model? Model is an abstraction of something for the purpose of understanding it before building it. We have generally seen that whenever, for example, you want to construct a house, you don't directly start. You lay out a blueprint of the plan. That is where you model it. Depending on the changes required, first you go ahead with the design and then you start implementing, which is actually constructing the real house. That's the reason model becomes important in developing a software also. First, you need to lay out a plan, you need to model it, and then on that basis, you need to find the solution. So what are we actually doing here? In order for software development, you first model it and then design it appropriately according to the problem at hand. Now, what is the importance of UML? We are going to deal with the subject and model it in a tool using Unified Modeling Language. Now, what do we mean by Unified Modeling Language? Why the name Unified in UML? Earlier, if you see, we had three languages. One was object-oriented software development by this person, Grady Booch. And then we have object-oriented software engineering by Ivar Jacobson and object modeling technique by James Rombaugh. All these three things were different, wherein people were studying different notations and there was no standardized language as such, wherein you could model the object-oriented concepts. Later, a decision was taken wherein all these three things were combined. That is the object-oriented software development, object-oriented software engineering, and object modeling technique. And then they came up with this unified modeling language, hence the name Unified, because it is a combination of all these three things. It happens to be a tool. For example, we have dealt with various object-oriented programming languages earlier also, like C++. So you know that object-oriented basically is centered around the object, where you create a class and then any number of objects you are able to create and work on that. So in this particular subject which we will be dealing with, object-oriented concepts remain the same. Our main focus would be how we are modeling or what are the different notations we are using in order to represent them so that we can model them in the form of a diagram. What is object-oriented? Now we understood what is an object, what is a class. Object-oriented means that we organize software as a collection of discrete objects that incorporate both data structure and behavior. So everything we are modeling in terms of objects, wherein we are referring to the data structure and behavior in terms of their attributes and operations. Those are the main things we are interested in. Now what are the different characteristics when it comes to object-oriented? What is the peculiarity regarding object-oriented? Then we have four things involved here. One is identity, inheritance, classification, and polymorphism. What happens in case of identity? Data is quantized into discrete distinguishable entities called objects, which means that every object has its inherent identity. For example, if I have two mangoes, they both belong to the same class called fruits, but then both those mangoes have individual identity. You need to eat the one and then eat the second one. You can't eat both at the same time. Similarly, if you take the example of twins, they may have similar features, look alike, but then they are two individual identities. That is what we mean by identity. Inheritance. When it comes to inheritance, it is a sharing of attributes and operations, wherein we see it is based on the hierarchical relationship, that is from the parent to the child, wherein the parent in programming terms is called the superclass and the child which inherits is called the child class. So what is the basic advantage of inheritance? It is, the main advantage happens to be reusability of code. You need not repeat the code again and again, so that whatever features are available with the parent, that are, they need not be defined again in the child class, and then the child class further elaborates its own features. When it comes to classification, that means your objects with the same data structure and behavior are grouped into a paragraph. Like for example, a paragraph, monitor, and chess piece are example of classes. When it comes to polymorphism, the same operation may behave differently for different classes. Poly is many, so one operation many forms. That is what we have learnt regarding polymorphism. Like you can take the example of the chess game, wherein the move operation behaves differently for a pawn than for a queen. It could be for a horse. The moves happen to be different even the same operation is move. So the object-oriented characteristics happen to be identity, inheritance, classification, and polymorphism. In this particular thing, we are modeling concepts and not implementation. So throughout, you will be seeing that when it comes to your SDLC lifecycle, that is a software development lifecycle, the different stages we know, wherein we collect the requirements, do the analysis, come up with a design, then start coding it, and then testing it, and then finally comes the implementation. So throughout, we will be dealing more of with modeling the solution, and when it comes to implementation, that is thought of later. Object-oriented methodology, basically, what are the different stages that are involved when it comes to software development? So you would see that we have system conception, analysis, system design, class design, and implementation. What do we mean by system design or system conception? So first thing that you do is how you conceive the idea of developing a software. Sometimes it could be based on the client requirement. Sometimes it could be totally new. Sometimes you are trying to automate certain things that are going on manually. So generally how you conceive that system idea, that is what you deal under system conception. After you have generated the idea and decided to develop a software for a particular thing, you do the analysis. What all things do you do in case of analysis? There are two things. One is the domain analysis, another is the system analysis. In case of domain, you analyze with respect to the infrastructure availability. When it comes to application, how useful end users are going to find your software. These are the main things you try to sit and analyze before proceeding ahead with the development of any kind of software. When it comes to system design, you're thinking at the top view level as to how the system is going to be. And when it comes to class design, you're basically dealing into specifics of what are the data structures, algorithms that you will be using, and then finally decide on the implementation, that is which programming language you would like to code the following things. So these are the stages that you follow in case of object oriented. When it comes to themes, we have abstraction, encapsulation, combining data and behavior, sharing, emphasis on essence of the object, and synergy. Abstraction, wherein you try to hide the details and look at the top level view. Encapsulation, where you're binding the data. How you combine the data and behavior. Sharing common code refers to, again, inheritance, where reusability is laid focus on. Emphasis on essence, where major importance is given to what the object is. And synergy, wherein all the above, when taken individually, are strong, but when you combine the advantages of all the above, that is the combined effect that is produced in terms of synergy. When it comes to the three models, these are the three pillars of object-oriented modeling design, where you deal with class model, state model, and interaction model. State model basically deals with the static structure. Now that you have decided to come up with a software, you need to decide what is its structure, what are going to be the different classes, what are going to be the different objects, how are they going to be related to each other, that is where you focus about relationship. And once you deal with this, finally you come up with a class diagram, wherein you are highlighting the different classes objects, how they are related to each other. Generally, when it comes to a statement, we see that the classes happens to be common nouns. So that is how you pick up and then try to highlight the relationships. When it comes to a state model, once you know that this is a static structure that is going to happen, then you need to keep track of the life history of objects, when they are created, when they are destroyed, what is the purpose that they have served. with respect to time. So that is where you come up with a state diagram which shows the life history of objects. And finally, you have the interaction model happening in the third pillar, wherein you see how the different classes interact with each other, and that you represent using a use case diagram, sequence diagram, or an activity diagram. These three diagrams fall under the category of interaction modeling. Now, what is the use of a use case? As the name suggests, use case. What is the basic functionality, or what is the different advantages that the software is going to provide it, you with? For what all purposes you're going to use it? Wherein you would have actors and use cases. Actors happen to be who all directly interact with the system, but they do not happen to be a part of the system. So how they interact, who are the actors, what are the different functionalities that it is going to provide. When it comes to a sequence diagram, what is the sequence of events that happen throughout a period of time? They don't show you the exact time at which things happen, but then the sequence in which. Sequence is an important matter because if you take a simple thing like a recipe, you know that there is a particular procedure given. First you need to do what, next what you need to do. Similarly, in case of software development, when it comes to interaction, who is interacting with whom first, next, and so on. That is what is highlighted by a sequence diagram. Activity diagram tells us the important operations that are taking place, the flow of it, and how things go around. So having seen all this, three models are going to form the base for our entire subject, wherein you will be dealing with the details of each of these in the further chapter. This happens to be an introductory chapter where I have just introduced you to the object-oriented concepts which we need to recapitulate in order to understand the further things. Your further chapters would include what all things or notations are involved when it comes to class modeling, and then it comes to advanced class modeling. Then we have state modeling and advanced state modeling. Finally, interaction modeling and advanced interaction modeling. Once we get to know the notations that are involved in all these three models, we further proceed ahead with the analysis and design part of this methodology in case of object orientation. Hence, it is very important for understand all the basics. The further class, this is all that I have for an introductory chapter. The next chapter we would be dealing with in our next class. Hope you go through this. For any queries, you can always text me. Thank you.